Good morning, children.
Good morning, children.
Good morning, children. Awesome, I love it. Can the student in the extreme end can hear me? Can you hear me? Very nice. Can the student in the extreme end hear me? Very nice. Good morning, everyone. It's truly an honor. First, thank you, AV team, for extending me an opportunity to come here and share my experience with you wonderful people. And thank you, Smita ma'am and Sarah ma'am, last night, for all the wonderful effort and hard work that they put in. This is the first time that I'm meeting them in person, and they are two incredible teachers that you guys have. So anyways, let's get started. So I was asked to deliver an inspirational speech on value education. And the word inspiration got me thinking. I think inspiration, it's a very short-lived expression. For example, when I watched Three Idiots, after 3 hours I had a screwdriver and next day I was opening up stuff. But then within a week, I stopped it. That inspiration died. You watch all these wonderful videos where astronauts walk in space by NASA. The next day I decided that I'll really pay attention to my physics, chemistry and math classes. But then after a week, it died. So inspiration is very short-lived. You hear somebody speak, you get inspired for a little while, and then you forget about it. And that's very natural that it happens. So I thought that we need something more concrete. We need something more solid to motivate ourselves with time, consistently. So that's when I looked at all these great names in history, which was up on the board a while back. And then I observed, what inspired them, what motivated them, what gave them, this stamina, this endurance, that they were able to pursue their passion throughout for years and years and years of research. And then I realized that they had an obsession. Can anybody explain what an obsession is? An obsession. A candy to anybody who can answer that. Yes, sir. Awesome, huge round of applause for that definition. So sir said, an obsession is something that never lets you sleep. An obsession is a passion. It motivates you, it doesn't let you sleep. Day and night you'll be thinking about it. Day and night you'll be thinking about pursuing and participating in that passion. Day and night you'll practice, day and night you'll dream about it. So I realized that this obsession fascinated these people. This obsession challenged them. They spent days and nights pursuing this obsession. So I figured out, it's this obsession that laid foundation for their incredible progress. A seed in itself doesn't give rise to a plant. In a similar way, an obsession doesn't automatically give you a result. So what's the action plan? What should we do? What do you children here do to get that incredible progress? And one of you guys will be tomorrow's Albert Einstein. One of you guys will be tomorrow's president. One of you will be an amazing athlete. So what is that? What is that one or three or 10 action plans that we gotta require? So with time, I discovered that there are three ingredients to achieve that incredible progress. Three simple tools. And I didn't realize this while I was progressing. Now that I look back, I could structure and organize all of that. And then I came up with three tools. These three tools are the dots that I found that can be connected backwards. I didn't know these three tools back then, but I just kept participating and pursuing my obsession. But now that I look back, these are the three tools that have always helped me. And probably can work for you too. So the first is knowledge. To be good at anything, to be good at science, to be good at sports, to be good at music, dance, you're gonna have knowledge. That's the first step to pursuing your passion. Knowledge, my dear friends, is everywhere. You guys are in good hands and you have the best teachers in this country. And this knowledge will give you strength. Now again back to the question, what's the action plan? How can we acquire knowledge? I found two tricks One, read newspapers, books, articles, social media, YouTube, you name it. There's a beautiful library just half a minute away, and there's so much knowledge lying out there. So that's one. And second way to acquire knowledge is through observation. Look around yourself. You know, why is that plant green? Chlorophyll. Why do we feel the way we are feeling right now? Why am I able to speak here right now and you guys are able to hear? Question every single thing that comes to your mind. Don't let accept anything without a logical answer. So observe. And you know, there have been times in my college career where, you know, I didn't understand even one word that was going in the lecture. So last semester I had this thermodynamics class and I didn't understand even one word that was going in the class. The professor was explaining all these temperature, fluids and all these concepts that just went way over my head. But all I did was sit there and observe. Because in this observation, I picked up few words. I picked up few sentences that probably I just kept in back of my mind. And then when it came time for preparing for the exam, these words made sense. While I was preparing for this toughest exam in my mechanical engineering degree, it all made sense. So similarly, if you don't understand anything that's going on in your class, just sit there and very peacefully observe. You'll pick up words, and trust me, friends, it'll help you down the lane. And then acquiring knowledge is exponential. It's very necessary. So that's the first step in case if you want to be great at something. Second is skill. You're going to have a skill set. Knowing 1 plus 1 is 2 is knowledge. But able to count is skill. So skill can be, you know, anything, right from knowing how to change a flat tire or singing or dance or music, you name it. So there's a saying, it takes 10,000 hours to be great at something. So in case if you keep playing piano for 10,000 hours, trust me, you'll be great at it. In case if you play soccer for 10,000 hours, you'll be great at it. Great, great, great at it. So while traveling to Gujarat last night from Delhi, so our car's engine, you know, overheated. So my dad was in the airport, so, you know, he played around with trucks for a while. So he knew why the car went overheating. And then, you know, using his workshop skills, he added engine coolant and some lubricant, and I'm here right now. So that's the skill set he developed while he was in the airport. He went to the little workshops, you know, here and there, and he learned those skills. So skill is second. And there was a very interesting thing that happened about the ISSS. It's called the International Space Station. So that's a little satellite that NASA sent, you know, up there. Make sure, you know, you take all images of the Earth for, you know, predicting climate and all, so on and so forth. So in the ISSS, there was a little rupture. There's a little, you know, there's a little piece of cloth that ruptured, that broke, that teared apart. And now the only solution was, you know, an astronaut had to go up there and then stitch it. That's the very simplest of, you know, skill anybody can ever pick. But then the astronaut knew how to stitch. So she put on her astronaut Sunita Williams, that's the astronaut's name. So she put on her suit, she did a little spacewalk, went to the site and then stitched it. And then that saved millions and millions of dollars and that saved 4 lives. So skill set is the second tool. And the third tool is the combination of knowledge and skill is where you gain experience. Using the knowledge you learn, practicing a little skill, you got to gain experience. Now the question, how do you guys can gain that experience, you know, in your shoes? So that's what brings me back to my 8th grade. The first way out that I could think of was taking part in competitions. You know, there were plenty and plenty of competitions online, offline, within school, outside school, national, international competitions that I could think of. So the first competition I took part was in 8th grade. So you know, a teacher, she came up with this brochure and it said, Dell Digital School of them, win a laptop. So you know, that got me attracted, that got me fascinated. How can I win a laptop? So then I explored the competition and the challenge was that I had to take an entire room, a very blank room, and turn it into a digital classroom. So this was way back in 2008. So I took the classroom and then I had to, you know, put some projector screens and then design it a little bit. So first, knowledge, you know, I went through a lot of books, did a little research online, and then for skill set, I learned a 3D design software. So in case if you want to design anything in this room, there are a couple of 3D design softwares like Google SketchUp, AutoCAD, SolidWorks. These are the softwares you use to design anything. So I acquired knowledge, developed a skill, and then put together a project. It took 1 week to put together a project, you know, thought about it a little while, gained inspiration from, you know, the best classrooms that existed in India, and then I submitted my project. And within a month, I realized that, you know, I'd won the competition, and I got my first laptop, my self laptop. That was beautiful. You know, tasting a little success, that was gorgeous. That experience, it's exponential, it's out of the world. That was the first push. And then in 1910, you know, one of my friends, he was taking part in this competition called the NASA Space Settlement. So what the challenge was, you had to build a house up in space. You had to come up with a planet. You have to create a parallel Earth somewhere in space. So let's say, you know, in case of, you know, due to global warming or in case of the Homo sapiens extinct here on Earth, we have to build a structure up in space where we can go and live, you know, build schools, hospitals, start a new life. So that was a challenge. So again, I acquired knowledge through books, online resources, past projects that everyone had done. And then I had to acquire skills. Again, back to the 3D design skills. You know, I went to a couple of architectural firms. You know, we learned 3D designing. So over the course of 1 year, there was very fast knowledge acquiring and skill set. Combined both, and then we put together a project. And we submitted, me and my dad was my mentor for the project, and then we got third in the International NASA Space Settlement Contest. So that was second success. You know, once you combine knowledge and skill, I was practicing, you know, this algorithm, I was practicing this little very simple trick, and it started working. And in 11th grade, you know, which was up there, the asteroid hunt, and it was a very similar project where we were given night sky screenshots, and then we had to analyze those images. Then, you know, we were giving all kinds of tools and techniques to, you know, understand these images. So that was, again, knowledge. And the skill set here was, you know, being able to understand, you know, how things work, what asteroids are. Combined both, and then we discovered an asteroid as a name. Me and my friend, the asteroid got named after us. That was exciting. That was in 11th grade. And towards the end of 11th grade, so this very fine Sunday, I got sick. You know, I had 101 fever, you know, I was coughing and I was in bed. So my mom decided to take me to the hospital. Since it was a Sunday, I went to a little private hospital because, you know, all these small clinics were shut. So there I went and, you know, I realized the cost of diagnosis is 800 rupees. So for a middle class person like me, it pinched my pocket. So imagine, you know, those millions out there, you know, who can't afford this 800 rupees. I came back home and then I had my other idea. You know, there was this competition which is called the Ignite, and a couple of, you know, minutes back there was a slide on patent. So National Innovation Foundation, they're an organization that file patents in case if you have an idea and in case if you can demonstrate that you can actually perform it, they'll help you file a patent for the technology. So these are the organizations, you know, that are taking India forward. So anyway, back to completing the story. So I put together a machine, you know, the image was up on the screen. So it's a kind of a machine that looks very similar to an ATM. So you stand in front of the machine, you tell the machine what your symptoms are, and then it'll take your pulse, heartbeat, etc. And then it'll tell you what illness or disease you're suffering from. And then it'll provide you medicine. Just like an ATM machine gives out cash, this machine will dispense medicine. So when I completed the design, which is again, you know, the skill set that I required. The skill set, you know, I had learned from the NASA project and the previous project. Put together everything and then I submitted the project. October 15th, I realized that I had won this competition. And now I get to meet the president, you know, of India. So I met Dr. Kalam, you know, at Ahmedabad on 11th of November 2011. And it was beautiful. You know, now while I was practicing the knowledge, the skill and the experience, it was working. And then after that, you know, I had to decide what I want to do with my life after 12th class. I mean, do I want to, you know, pursue a college degree in one of the colleges here? Or, you know, if I wanted to look for a better opportunity. So that's when the United States seemed like the American dream, with, you know, tons and tons of opportunities for research and designing and whatnot. So that got me thinking, that got me interested, and that's when I, you know, applied to some US colleges. And then, you know, first attempt I didn't get it, I, you know, shared the experience in a little while. When the second attempt I got it, so I flew to the United States in January, last year, and then I started my college in mechanical engineering, a bachelor's in mechanical engineering. Anyways, truth be told, the journey was never a barren process. There were plenty and plenty of struggles. There were more failures than there were success. So start, the, one of the most important failures that I, you know, I wanted to share now that I have the audience was, so after 12th when I applied, you know, to this university that I was really interested in, I didn't get in. I got a rejection letter and my 2 years dream broke. This happened on March 15th, you know, while my exams were happening. And this affected, you know, the exams and, you know, so on and so forth. So now I was up the creek without a paddle. I had no idea what to do with my life. I didn't apply to any of the colleges here, but then, you know, this dream broke. And then, you know, I, of course, I had to take national, you know, I had to get enrolled in a private university and, you know, whatnot. My friends became strangers. Everyone, you know, lost hope. Everyone gave up. That, hey, I mean, he messed up. So, you know, what is he going to do with his life? But then I was composed. Not because I didn't get into the university, because I had a little knowledge about the stuff that I wanted to get into, and then I had a skill set. So I was very confident that, you know, I'll do something. So that kept me going, you know, that motivated me. That's the inspiration, you know, I see. So I retook all the exams that initially I had thought, and then I strengthened my application, found out strategies that what caused this failure. Why did I fail? Why did I cause that rejection? But I made these connections, networked with admission offices while they were here in New Delhi. And then, you know, I applied again, and then I got into the university. So that was a huge success. You know, that was just tasting success at the right time. And then I went to the US. So first semester that I was in my college, I got into a New York Engineering Design Center. So there they needed somebody who can design stuff for them. So that was again, you know, going back to the skill set that I had learned on those competitions while I was gaining experience. So this is a very interesting project that came to the lab. So a 16-year-old girl, she lost her hand during an accident. So she didn't have a hand. So we had to design a prosthetic arm for her. So that prosthetic arm is, you know, a little piece of plastic that, you know, fits into your hand and then you can start moving around. It gives you a hand. It's like an artificial hand that you can place and it can move, it can change life. So we had to come up with a 3D printer. So just like, you know, we have printers here, 2D printers that, you know, prints on paper, we needed a 3D printer that can 3D print. So any object you can design, you know, be it a mic or a pen or a pencil or anything around in this room, you can 3D print. So in 3 weeks, we built this 3D printer and then we met this girl. You know, we took dimensions of her hand, you know, understood how it all worked. Then we did a, you know, research that how we can, you know, implant this hand on her. So for another 4 weeks during the summer, I was working on this 3D hand for her. So me and my research assistant, we you know, kept designing and, you know, found various combinations that we could fit. And we were working very closely with some doctors so that, you know, the body doesn't reject, you know, this hand while we implant. In 3 months, you know, we had 3D printed the hand, and then on very one fine Sunday morning, we went to the hospital and then we gifted her this hand. The doctor nicely implanted, and then she was able to move her hand all over again. So with the knowledge, the skill, the experience that I had gained, I was able to make a difference. When we gave her this hand, she had the most beautiful smile and tears were rolling down her family and her eyes. So that's why, you know, these three things are very critical to progress and to, you know, inspire yourself. And friends, you know, summarizing, you know, the entire speech, dare to dream. You know, have a dream. Dream big. Because you got to find an obsession and you got to pursue it. The future really belongs to those, you know, who believe in the beauty of your dreams. And luck is when hard work meets an opportunity. If you're prepared, opportunities will find you. Having said that, I wish you all good luck. Be obsessed, and be obsessed. Thank you very much.